BBC Audio presents Last Chance to See, featuring Douglas Adams and Mark Carwardine, who travel the world in pursuit of species on the brink of extinction. In 1985, The Observer magazine sent Douglas Adams to Madagascar to look for the exotic and potentially extinct II lemur. There he met zoologist Mark Carwardine, and together they made a radio pilot about their travels in search of the II. This led to a hugely popular radio series, Last Chance to See. Part travelogue, part natural history show, this unforgettable account of a remarkable voyage of discovery serves as a reminder to protect our planet while we still can.
Well, the purpose of the expedition was to find the extremely rare, in fact, virtually extinct creature, the II, which is a form of lemur. Now, the lemurs themselves are actually extremely rare in that they only exist on Madagascar. Now, this is true of most things that live on Madagascar. Virtually everything that lives there does not exist anywhere else because Madagascar is kind of life raft from a previous age of our own planet, 100 million years ago. Madagascar was part of Africa, and it sheared off at about that time and went off over the horizon into the Indian Ocean, taking with it a fairly good cross-section of the wildlife around at the time, prime amongst which were the lemurs, which were the leading primates of the day, because the monkeys hadn't come along yet. When the monkeys came along later, they were a great deal cleverer than the lemurs, competed with them fiercely, and the lemurs basically could not survive. They were completely supplanted by the monkeys, except on Madagascar, because the monkeys never got to Madagascar. So they've lived there for 100 million years. And evolution has really been playing its own little sort of independent game over there, completely untouched by the rest of the world. Anyway, the II, which is where we started off. The II is the strangest of the lemurs. For a long time, it wasn't even thought that it was a lemur. Let me tell you what it looks like. It looks like a cross between a cat and a fox with big bat ears and big bright red eyes, which sort of stare at you out of the tree if you're lucky enough to see one, and very, very few people have seen them. It has a sort of a slightly dog-like snout with two little pointy teeth, like rabbits, and rather sort of coarse fox-like hair. No, because fox hair isn't coarse, but this is a coarse version of fox hair. It has the most extraordinary stare, which looks as if it's being continually startled by something happening in a dimension of which we are not aware. And the strangest thing it has is this long, skeletally thin middle finger, which it uses for poking in under the bark of trees and grubbing out little insects. This is, of course, what the monkeys developed sticks for. But the II has this long, skeletally thin finger, which looks very, very curious. Now, the name of the II is in itself odd. And no one actually knows what its proper name is. When I say proper name, I mean the name that the Malagasy call it by, because they regard it as a malevolent spirit. And if you saw one, you'd know why. This is an odd-looking creature. And they are essentially frightened of it, and for years would kill it if they saw it. And II is actually, apparently, the cry of fear that they would emit when they saw this creature. And then the actual name, they won't actually tell anybody because they won't say it. You know, it's one of these things that to say the name is bad luck. Somebody told me that it was supposed to be the actual cry of the II itself, and it clearly isn't, because that's more sort of noise, I think. But this naming of animals is very strange, you see, because I was told, and I've no idea whether this is true or not, so and I don't want to know if it isn't true, because I enjoy thinking that it might be, that the word kangaroo is actually the aborigine for, what did you say? Apparently the scene was that the first white settlers saw this thing suddenly leaping across his vision and said, "What's that?" And an aborigine said, "Kangaroo." Now, whether that's true or not, coming back to Madagascar, I'm fairly certain it's true of the sifaka, or shifak, as it's pronounced in Malagasy. A lemur which does look quite a lot like a monkey. Actually, it looks more like a man in a monkey suit. It's small, and it wears this kind of white monkey suit. It'll sit in a tree staring at you for hours on end, and then suddenly, for no apparent reason, hurl itself with reckless abandon at another tree and just disappear. And it moves with incredible grace through the trees. Put it on the ground, and it moves in the most extraordinary way. It actually looks like a flamenco dancer that's got stuck halfway through a routine and sort of hops off stage with his hands still held locked above his head. Anyway, sifaka, or shifak, apparently is the Malagasy for look at that. Anyway, the aye-aye. Well, there are very, very few of them. The exact numbers aren't known, but in 1966, 9 of them were taken from the forests on the east of Madagascar and taken out to the small island refuge called Nosy Mangabe, which is a rainforest island. And nobody is allowed there without sort of government permits in triplicate and so on and so forth. And anyway, this little expedition I went on, we were allowed there. There were just 4 of us. And we spent several nights there, sort of sleeping on concrete floors in this hut in the middle of the rainforest, and traipsing around the forest at night with torches, sort of huddled under rain capes and things, looking for this creature. Actually, because it kept on pouring with rain, I mean, it was a rainforest. we used to have to keep on taking shelter in this strange hut, which is a deserted lighthouse keeper's hut, which had some of the most nauseating, I think, wildlife I've ever come across in it. We used to sort of hide in this place, sort of surrounded by these sort of grotesquely large spiders, which are actually eating cockroaches. And if you held quiet, you'd hear the little sort of crunching noise going on around with these spiders eating cockroaches. And every time we had to take shelter again, we'd find some great sort of bulbous great slug or something, and all the dust in it was the decaying husks of insects, and it was the most disgusting place I've ever been. So anyway, we would shelter in this hut when it was pouring with rain. We had this guide from the Ministry des Eaux et Forêts who was actually responsible for giving us a lot of the information, and he was apparently renowned as an expert at being able to find the aye-aye. The only times he actually did manage to find it were when he wasn't around, but he had got one of our torches. We actually became extremely annoyed at this guy, because virtually everything he told us turned out not to be true, but usually almost immediately. After hours sheltering in this nauseating hut, he would suddenly announce how the eyes never came out in the rain anyway. And we would think, what on earth are we doing here then? And we, you know, when we've got nice cosy concrete floors to go back to in the other hut. And we finally managed to see it when he went away. Unfortunately, he had our best torch with him, but he was off thrashing through the trees at some considerable distance. And we also had with us, and no one quite knew what he was doing here, because no one had introduced him to us, and he must have been on the boat, though we can't remember seeing him on the boat, which is strange, because it was a very small boat, certainly there was very little of it above the water. There's a little old toothless Malagasy peasant who had a tiny flickering little torch. And anyway, Joel, our man from the ministry, was way off in the trees, sort of thrashing around. And suddenly this guy just sort of beckoned us over, just sort of very quietly. And we came over, we couldn't see very well because the guide was off with our best torch. And there, up in the tree, was this creature, and we couldn't believe it. That here we'd finally found it. And it was just sort of sitting there in the crook of a branch, just sort of looking out at us. And as soon as it realized we had seen it, it sort of prowled back along the branch and sort of cast a sort of few malevolent glances back at us, and then just disappeared off into the forest. Meanwhile, there were sort of noises coming from the distance where our guide was still thrashing around in the wood with our best torch. And that was really just about it, actually. I mean, that was all we managed to see of this creature. But it was one of those sort of frozen moments, you know, when you think, this is actually going on now, and what am I going to do about it? Here I am, I'm looking at this thing, and it's there, and I've seen it, and I'm seeing it now, and now, and it's gone. Damn. Thank you.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.